So let's go over the solution to this problem, starting with the definition of the acceleration function. We know that the acceleration due to gravity points downward, so we can split this vector into two components. We have one component right here that is parallel to the string of the pendulum, and another component that is perpendicular to this green one. Now we know that the acceleration in this direction is going to be exactly canceled out by the acceleration due to the tension in the rope. So that means that the acceleration we're looking for is really just this pink component, which at any point along the path is going to be tangent to the trajectory. Now, if we call this angle theta right here, then we can figure out the length of this pink component by just saying that it is equal to the length of the resultant vector times the sine of theta. Now, theta down here is actually exactly equal to theta in the diagram of the pendulum itself. So that means to figure out the length of this component, we can use information that we already know about this larger diagram. Since position is just the arc length right here of this imaginary circle, then the measure of that angle in radians is going to be equal to the length of the arc that it corresponds to divided by the radius of that circle. So that means that in our case, theta is equal to arc length over radius, or position over length. So since theta equals position over length, and we want the sine of theta, we fill in our definition for acceleration as negative g, or negative the magnitude of the acceleration due to gravity, times the sine of position over length. Okay, moving on to our symplectic Euler function. You had to fill in this for loop with the input num initial conditions. As I said in the intro video for the problem, we wanted the initial x to vary from 1.75 to 2.25, and the initial v to vary from negative 2 to 2. Corresponding to the coordinates of every point along that green circle that I showed you. Now, a convenient way to make a variable cycle through values that are symmetric about an equilibrium value is to use sine or cosine, so we're going to keep that in mind. Now, as you learned from the circular orbit problem of Unit 1, if we consider any point along the circumference of a circle, then we can define an angle that corresponds to that point. We start counting from right here as the zero radian mark. We can write the coordinates of this point, then, as the radius of the circle times the cosine of the angle. That's for the horizontal component. And for the vertical component, we get the radius times the sine of the angle. In the phase space plot that I showed you in the intro video, we saw that position lay along the horizontal axis and velocity lay along the vertical axis. So we wanted to plot the coordinates of the points on that green circle, the initial condition circle. We know that position is going to correspond to cosine, and the velocity is going to use sine. Now in our code, we created a variable called phi. You could pick any name you want, I guess. And phi effectively splits a circle into 49 segments by marking out 50 different points along the circumference. So every time I increases by 1, we're going to step to the next point along the circumference. Since, as you saw in the phase space plot, we had a complete circle of green points, the x values of those green points vary like this, with 2 as the middle value, and the v coordinates vary like this. You notice that the amplitude in either case corresponds to the half length of the green shape in that direction. So actually what we had in the phase space plot was an ellipse for that set of initial conditions. So now that we have our starting conditions figured out, we can finally use the symplectic Euler method to approximate the values of x and v at later steps. So this code right here is just a direct translation, pretty much, of the equations that I showed you earlier. Now let's go back to looking at the plot that we get from this program. Now first, let's look at our top two plots. The horizontal axis in both of them represents time measured in seconds. The vertical axis in the top one is x measured in meters, and here it is v measured in meters per second. So we can see that our initial values of x go from 1.75 to 2.25, and v from negative 2 to 2. So that corresponds to this green ellipse right here. So the most important thing to notice about this bottom graph, which, like I said earlier, represents phase space, is that if we look closely at each one of these ellipses, they all have the same area. Now let's look at the shapes that we have down here in this bottom graph. Now if you look closely and do a bit of calculating, you'll notice that all of these different colored shapes have the same exact area, even though they're all, well, shaped very differently. This is a great example of how phase space is conserved in a system where energy is conserved. Now the fact that this conservation principle holds in this diagram shows how the symplectic Euler method improves upon the accuracy of the forward Euler method. When the forward Euler method is used, it often results in the energy steadily increasing. So that would mean that the area of each of these shapes down here would get progressively bigger. The symplectic Euler method, however, conforms much better to the equations of motion of physics and therefore reflects exact theoretical predictions more accurately. Great job with the first problem of Unit 2.